Are you saying
you faked with me?
Yeah.
Wrong. Now you're single.
What do you know about sexual relations?
Is it true that if you don't use it, you lose it?
I'm a little worried about being a slut.
You're listening to the Come With Us podcast, talking the good, the kinky, and the ugly. Here are your hosts, Beth, Aaron, and Tina.
Hello, 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 all you sexy holes and poles. Welcome to Come With Us podcast, where we know that sexy stuff matters just as much as all the lovey-dovey stuff. So we are here to help you get all of the pleasure that you deserve. 'Tis the season to be sexy, so today we're talking about how to give your favorite naughty elf or naughty Santa or naughty Mrs. Claus or anybody that you want an erotic spanking, right? It sounds so easy, but I don't know. Sometimes it just doesn't go off very well or go on very well. So I don't know. But it can be so much fun to be pulled over your lover's lap, have your skirt slid up and your panties pulled down, to feel their hand just spanking your ass, whether it's a kinky technique that you like to use during sex or part of domestic discipline for some infraction on your part, on their part. I don't know. And it doesn't matter. It's not just women who like to get spanked. There are men, lots and lots of men, who like to be spanked also. So if you're ready to join the legion of people, like throughout history, actually, who like to spank, and you want to know how to give a really good or get a really good erotic spanking, this, you're in the right place. I'm Beth Darling from BethDarling.com here with Aaron. Tina is out gallivanting someplace across the world, so she's not here. I know she likes a good spanking. I like a good spanking. Aaron, do you like a good spanking?
I actually do.
You do?
Yep. What? Giving and receiving.
See, I love that. Thank you for sharing that, right? Because I don't know about you, but like it took me years to be able to say that I liked spanking. I was so embarrassed. Like, how could I be this, you know, smart, successful, independent woman and want to get my ass beaten? Like, it's just crazy.
Okay, well, there's a difference between spanking and getting your ass beaten.
Okay, well, that's true. I like to get my ass beaten, but I love, like, but spanking is part of it. Like, I just like, again, my ADHD, I need things to really feel. So,
yeah.
But some people like a very, just a light, like, they like the play, the like, a spanking that doesn't feel so much, just sort of a light impact spanking.
Yeah.
Some people like it more. But did you have any problem, like, saying that you liked it?
Did
it feel weird to you?
Not really. I mean, it's just my wife and I. So really, I didn't have a problem. Like, I think she thought I was kidding the first time I said it.
And so what did you say? Did you ask to spank her first or ask her to spank you first?
I mean, in the gradual, like, evolution of our relationship, because we've been together, 12 years now. Yeah. I mean, I spanked her first. Uh-huh. And it was still in our, like, carnal honeymoon of dating phase where we were just, like, going completely wild on each other. That's when it started.
Yeah.
And it progressed, and I enjoyed doing it. And then it progressed and progressed. And then we had a little bit of a rough patch somewhere around the early middle where it, like, then I was spanking too hard for her. And she didn't know how to tell me. And finally, like, it turned into like an argument of like, you always hit me too hard. And like, okay, well, if you don't communicate that to me, I don't know what to, and so then it became it's very weird because I'm a very auditory person and it's,
Oh, the sound of spanking is so cool.
We're going to have to do an entire thing on just auditory stimulation because I'm pretty sure I could get off just from auditory stimulation if it were right. But the sound of like my hand, like any hand spanking is an awesome sound. And so I had to eventually, after a while, learn to balance between how to get the sound without the pain.
Ooh, right. Okay. That's a good thought. Okay.
But, I like that. And then, so I started it first early in our relationship and then she did it to me couple years ago or whatever, and I guess she wasn't expecting my reaction, and I was like, okay, do it again, and she was like, why? And it wasn't, we weren't even in a sexual like situation, it was just like we were doing something around the house and I was in the way. And so that's how she decided to get me to move. And she, and at first when she did it, I remember her going, she did it, and she did it what she thought was like hard and violent. And she was like, see, it doesn't feel good, does it? And I was like, no, it does feel good. Actually, that didn't even register. Like, you could like really hard, like haul off and smack me. And she was like, no, that's not what you like. I was like, okay. And it's also very weird that we've been together since our early 20s. Like, we've been on a giant journey of expanding and discovering new things that we like sexually together. Yeah. So that was just something that never occurred to me, never occurred to her in the relationship that I would like. And then it happened and we were like, oh, cool. So now every now and then she will, if I'm doing something that, you know,
not even acting up
like a warranted punishment thing. Just like if I'm doing something that isn't going, like we have a rule, not when one of us is brushing our teeth or using Q-tips or anything where like jarring of your body can jar.
Okay, that's a good rule.
But like if I just finished washing my face before bed and I'm drying it off and I'm like hunched over the sink and she's walking through the bathroom or done or already ready for bed or going to get ready for bed and she wants to, she does. So
that's awesome. Yeah. Well, so, okay. So I like it. And I love that you touched on a couple of things that I think we can help people with, because not knowing how hard is too hard is definitely a problem. And in fact, a lot of people just won't even start because they're just afraid that it's going to be too hard. So we definitely, we can help them with that. And I think the other thing is, like, I love that you guys are on such a journey, right? Because that's the way, if we do things right, that's the way life should be. That's the way relationships should be, that they just keep growing and that there's always new stuff. You know me, I love the idea that we can be virgins at any age. There's always stuff we haven't done yet. And it's fun to explore with your partner because you like it or you don't like it, but at least you did it together.
I hope this isn't the case, but knowing the odds, it is the case. So there's a guy or a girl listening right now who's just like seething with, God, I hate how great your relationship is and y'all can do that and I can't with my partner. It took a while. It took a while for us to both get to the point where we opened up of like, oh, hey, there's more to explore together. And rather than, you know, getting freaked out by it, just kind of let go of the steering wheel for a bit and let's see where it takes us kind of thing. And I mean, like I said, we've been together for 12 years. We've known each other since we were children. Like we got to a point where we were now comfortable enough with each other that one of us can suggest some different way of playing or some different like kink or something like that, that just crossed our mind. And the other one goes, all right, cool. Let's figure it out. Let's figure out if I'm into it. Let's figure out if you're actually into it or you're into the idea of it, not the actual practice kind of thing.
Exactly. Yeah,
it took a while. It took a long time of being not only comfortable with each other, but comfortable with ourselves internally to know that, hey, whatever's up, like, I'll try it if it's going to make you happy. And if we go down that path and one of us doesn't like it, cool, we can take it off the table. If one of us does, and I, you know.
Yeah.
So if you're listening and you're hopefully not in like a dead bedroom, but your partner's not as adventurous as you would like, don't think that it's going to be that way forever. Or don't think that there's not a way that you can branch out and grow together.
Right. Because, you know, so this was my sort of my story of my marriage was we'd been married for 10 years. We were separated. I got drunk. And again, you know, I don't really drink very much. And I was out with friends. So I went back. He was with the kids. I went back and then asked him to spank me. Like, it took us being separated and me being drunk for me to ask for this, even though I had always wanted it. But then I asked and he freaked out because he didn't know what to do. And then I freaked out thinking I was like a pervert or crazy or I don't know, just so ashamed that I had desires that did not seem politically correct. And so we didn't. And I never asked for anything else. And we were married for 12 more years. So again, this is, you know, I wish that I had me to kind of talk to and say, hey, it's okay. He just doesn't know what to do. And I think there are lots of us, lots of people are just willing, hey, we don't know, but we're just going to go, I'm going to go figure it out and I'll try it. But then there are a lot of us who get too much in our heads and we freeze up. So for those of you like that, or if your partner is like that, this is a great episode to just kind of send and say, hey, can we just talk about this afterwards and let us do some of the heavy lifting for you and break those taboos.
And it doesn't even have to be like, honestly, if you're listening to this right now, do you think, oh, well, you know, I'm not into spanking. It doesn't even have to be about spanking. It just let them listen to this first. I don't know, however long we're going to go on this part of the journey. Of, hey, like there's stuff I want to try. There's stuff I want to explore, but I want to do it with you. I don't want, you know, like, right. 'Cause that's the thing. And knowing you, I've never met your ex-husband, but I am pretty confident and able to say that I don't need to meet him to know that you're better off. And that wasn't a good, healthy thing to be in to begin with.
Yeah. No, it
I know
it
your kids. Not. I love your kids. And this is right. The problem is every parent who, you know,
right. We wouldn't trade it.
Divorce, they go, oh, well, you know, but it gave me my kids. Okay. That doesn't mean it was still right from the get go.
Oh, no, no, it was not. No
thing. Like that's the thing, right. Every person with children that goes through it that I know always goes, well, there's my silver lining that I had kids. Okay, well, that doesn't matter. That take that off the table. Stop trying to silver line something that wasn't good and wasn't healthy for you. Well, they gave me my kids. Okay, good for you. But we're not dealing with
right.
that.
Guess do what? Better in the future. Right. Make better choices.
Well, yes, but yeah. And yes, they're always your kids. But after 18, they go off and they forge their own life. The whole goal of the...
Well, they're supposed to. Easy to say.
They're supposed to. I didn't exactly. I mean, I bounced around a lot, but the whole point of having a life partner, a person you're going to raise another set of humans with and teach them the way, is that you get them to that point where they you get the hell out of my nest, go fly, and then you go back to being the two of you. Yeah. And right. It so make wasn't sure going to be healthy right. for you.
Right. But know that you can also just give somebody a chance and recognize that sometimes trying new things might just scare people a little bit and they might need a little bit more time to adjust. And you might need a little bit more time. Or maybe you try things the first time, like a new recipe. You try it. It doesn't turn out well. Instead of just saying, oh, I'm never going to do that again. Just say, okay, let's think about what could we do differently and try it a couple of times before you give up. That's kind of, I think that's important. So, so let me just address a couple of issues. So first of all, spanking in terms of, is this just like a modern day thing? No, I will tell you that I think it's about 1,000 years ago, some archaeologists or whatever researchers, they found what they call frescoes, like hand-painted drawings from ruins from about 1,000 years ago that had a woman bent over, a picture of a woman bent over getting spanked by a young guy while an older guy was right in front of her kind of laughing at it, right? So it was not only spanking, but it was like a threesome and her skirts were up. So spanking has been a pleasurable thing. For as long as people have been around. So don't think that you're doing something that wasn't, you know, natural. The fact is, it is natural. People just started doing this way back when there was porn on the internet. So
way before there was an internet.
Exactly.
I mean, the internet was literally if you had money, you went to the local artist and you said, draw me this and here's my absorbent amount of money. And I'm going to go hide this in my chamber and I'm going to look at it when nobody else is around. Kind of weird thing.
That's right. Anyways, and it gave them pleasure. So,
I mean, this is going to sound really, I don't know, sexist, whatever, but the female ass is just begging to be. Like a good, like that, I can understand where it started as like in like that far back in human history. You could make me fucking caveman number two. And guess what? If cavewoman walks by with a nice ass, it's like, well, what else could I do with that? Like, that's just, I mean, that's one of many things, but that's one of the first things that came to mind. Yeah. And it's just instinctual.
It just begs. Right. And it turns so nice and pink and red, you know, it turns some colors really nicely. And we have lots of padding there to do, which is really nice. And, and by the way, for women who are concerned, like that their butts, well, nowadays it's good to have a bubble butt, but you know, in the kink community, what I love is that having a bigger butt is a good thing because there's more area to spank, which I think is kind of a win, you know, for curvaceous women. But the other thing I think that very quickly turns people off or makes them concerned about spanking is this idea that they don't want to, quote, cause somebody pain. Or two, along that same thing, is that sort of men have been raised never to hit a woman. And I think those are very important things. And so let me just suggest that we switch your thought, that you think of spanking not as pain, because we have a negative association with that, but as just simply a level of sensation. And just as we started at the beginning, you could do a very light spanking, you know, just light love pats, to a really serious, intensely sensational, like lots of sensation. And you get to decide that and your partner. So we can help you set things up so that you make sure that you keep it within the realm of pleasure. And then it's not hitting. It's literally about giving your partner pleasure.
Well, and I mean, that was also what I was going to say, is that there's a difference between spanking and hitting, first off. But also, yes, there's a difference between, because I was raised the same way, and no, you don't ever hit a woman. There's a difference between spanking a woman when she wants it.
Right, consensual.
Yes.
Consent.
And hitting a woman. Now, there's also a difference between, there are some people out there who like it really rough. There are some women who want to be slapped across the face and want to be slapped across the face hard. Okay, yes. That, again, when they're asking for it, and it's not, here's the thing. I've likened this to a buddy of mine who talks about how he raises his kids. When his kids get in trouble and they deserve an actual punishment spanking, it's never, even no matter what happens, he doesn't do it the second they screw up.
Yes.
I'm not going to do this out of anger. I'm going to send, he sends them to their room. Mm-hmm. He cools off. He takes a breath, thinks his process through, gets his words together, then calls them back out, explains why they're getting the spanking, why you're punished, what you did wrong, and then explain. So they don't see angry dad just hauling off and do it. Right. That's the difference between hitting and, you know, in the actual adult consensual relationship, spanking or slapping or stuff like that. Doing it out of anger. You're not slapping your partner
or aggression
in the bed because you want to take something out on them.
Right.
You're not
or
doing
violence.
Because, yes.
Right.
Yeah. So, I mean, so consent is the biggest.
It's intentional.
Yeah.
It's deliberate.
Yes.
And it's with thought.
And I've said before, like, we've talked, right? Well, God, this had to be our first, like, 3 or 4 months of doing the show together. You brought up the fact of, you know, women who want to be really, really hit. And I said, no matter what, I would never go. I don't care how tough. I don't care if it's a UFC fighter. I don't care if it's a female bodybuilder who would be into it and go, give me all you got. I'm not scared. And like, I want it. I would never go 100%. I wouldn't go 70% because I know my own strength and I know what I've done to another human being in a non-sexual way, violent wise. I've known what I've done to myself, hitting a wall, putting my fist through drywall before. I am nowhere near going to go full steam ahead on a partner.
Right. Anybody who asks you to go full steam without knowing what that is, like that's stupid. Like, again, I'm not trying to be judgmental, but again, this is supposed to be about pleasure and it's got to be for everybody's benefit and comfort. And so you need to know what things are, which is why anytime, even if you're with a new partner and you're an expert spanker, you start slow because you don't know. Some people are incredibly sensitive to touch. Some people are incredibly sensitive to sound. There's just all sorts of different people and levels. And until you know how the two of you work, then you don't just haul off. That's just absurd and foolish and dangerous and a good way to make sure that you never actually enjoy. So, yeah. So don't do that. But along with that, so part of what also happens is that I think people need to understand like why I like so much sensation, right? Why I like what some people might consider, oh, isn't that painful? I was like, I don't know. It just feels a lot to me. So, if somebody else was doing it, if I wasn't turned on, I would probably be like, stop that. This hurts. But in the context of me with a partner that I like and trust and am comfortable and in turn on, then that sensation is pleasurable. And no matter where it is, when you like it, that sensation starts releasing endorphins. And those endorphins start making us feel good. And when people who think, oh my God, how could, you know, spanking, I say it can get you high. And it's just like a runner's high. just like a runner's high. And frankly, I don't understand why somebody would run so much that they get high. I can't even imagine that. But when it comes to spanking, I totally, totally believe it and understand it. So, so again, just think about that, the physical benefits, the high you get, and be aware also that spanking, when you hit the butt, because that's particularly what we're talking about. When you hit the butt, it starts waking up all those nerve endings down in the genital area and starts waking everything up. It's like when you have an itch in one place, suddenly everything starts itching all around it, right? Our nerves wake up. So spanking is a really good way to start getting all the different our parts down there, whether you're a boy or a girl, everything gets aroused. The blood flow starts going there. Everything wakes up. It starts going, ooh, touch me more. Give me more. So I think that's an important thing to recognize. That's why spanking particularly, that area, spanking the butt area is particularly, it's just like, as Aaron was saying, it's got this little target going, pleasure here. On men and women. So, yeah, I think that's kind of a cool thing. So, okay. And I think that maybe you can also, if spanking has a negative connotation to people because they were punished with it and stuff, then you can call it an erotic spanking. And sometimes just having that word erotic helps give that framework for this is about turn on. This isn't about childish kind of behavior. This is about turn on. So, I think that that's kind of a good thing. And, and then spanking, like for me, spanking is a lot about the dominance and the power and not being in control. But so that's that BDSM, you know, bondage, bondage, discipline, dominance, submission, sadism, masochism stuff. But, other people just like the physical sensation of it.
Yeah.
So I don't know. Do you get in? I think you get into kind of both, don't you?
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah. I mean, it's more to me, it's more the sensation. Personally, I guess. I don't know. It depends on how far, you know, we go down that rabbit hole. But yeah. Typically, 9 times out of 10, it's just the sensation. Like I can clap extremely loud. And I also enjoy, like, if I ever, like, somebody, I say this and people all the time go, no, you can't. And they go, clap. And so then after like 2 or 3 really loud ones right near their face, they go, oh, crap, that is loud. But then my hand is bright red and it burns a little bit and it tingles and stuff like that. And it's like, yeah, that, I mean, I have, it's different nerve endings than in, you know, the other parts of your body because,
yeah,
like, well, your hands are meant to be worn down, calloused. You're, you know, you're meant to lose nerve endings there. But yeah, yeah, it's a lot more the feeling, the initial feeling, the sting, the, like I said, part of it is the sound, the sound of me when I'm doing it or when it's being done to me, just that sound. When you get a really good, it's awesome.
Yeah. So, and I like that, but I think it's important. So people out there, like you can realize that you might like one thing and your partner might like another, but this is why you really want to actually talk about it. Well, and think about it first, because like, then if the sound is so important, you might not like spanking if you weren't allowed to make noise. And that would be important to know. And other people might just love the positioning, right? There's just something about being bent over somehow. If you're a guy and you're bent over, but your pants are like around your ankles, right? There's something a little bit, I don't know, like a little humiliating, a little bit erotic sometimes for some people in that. Others find it completely unpleasant and wouldn't enjoy it.
So, yeah, like the humiliation aspect for me, that wouldn't do anything for me. That you'd do the opposite direction kind of thing. That's not what it's about for me. But yeah, it depends. And I mean,
people need to know this, that they don't have to, that it's not the same for each and everybody. Never will be.
And it, from at least from a male perspective, like the thought and the image of seeing a woman bare ass bent over, not only is it a great thing to look at, but also it, at least for me, awakens that like primal, like lion getting ready to pounce on a freaking gazelle that's unknowing in the middle. Like if you watch any of those nature shows or did when you were a kid, you saw when the lioness or you know, the cheetah is getting so close to that animal and that animal has no idea what's coming for it. And all of a sudden it's just on top. I like that. I mean, there's something about that carnal awakening of like that, like she is exposed. She's right there. Like I am 100%. I could, you know, I could become that cheetah really quickly if I wanted.
So this is why I love doing the show with you, Aaron, because it would never in a million years have occurred to me. And especially for you, because yeah, I don't have that. And I watch that and all I do is feel so sorry for the cheetah. I just can't stand it. I'm like, run, run, run.
Oh, the gazelle?
The gazelle or whatever. Yeah, life. Sorry. Yeah. I know. I just can't stand it. So it's so funny. But
yeah, again, it's vulnerability. That's also, I guess for me, a part of the turn on is that she is vulnerable right there. And it is up to me. Like I could go one way or I could go the other, or I could do it whenever I want. It could be on, you know, this moment. It could be 30 seconds in the future. I don't know.
Oh, so it's a little bit of power, because that is kind of power too.
Yeah, there is.
Yeah. Which is pretty cool. So yeah, I like that. And again, the fact that you like giving and receiving too. I think that's pretty cool. So again, and I think that's part of, I just thought that being the receiver made me weak or whatever or something. And it's just not the case. Again, the pleasure is mutual. So it just takes two to do it. So it doesn't matter which side of it you're on. You're just adding to pleasure for you and for your partner. So,
yeah.
And okay. So then like some people just in the middle of sexy stuff, they don't actually ask their partner or talk about spanking. They just kind of start doing it in the middle of sexy stuff. And, you know, I mean, I guess that's okay. That idea of ask forgiveness, not permission. But it seems to me like maybe, you know, then you do it, but then you're afraid to go too hard. And maybe then they're afraid to ask too much, or they just think you're just doing what you want. So one way or the other, I think talking about it is always going to be better. Even if you just do that a little bit once and then you talk afterwards and say, "Ooh, how did you feel? You know, I really liked spanking you. In fact, I might like doing it again. How did you feel about it?"
What have I said since episode one? Communication is the key. Always and forever. And again, if you find yourself like, and I mean, nobody's listening to this while they're doing it, but if you've thought about it and you found yourself wanting to do it, or you think about doing it while in the middle of it and you haven't, you know, broached this topic with your partner before, that's when the dirty talk and the creativity come into it on like asking for permission, but also, you know, making it sexy, you know, oh my God, the way you're bent over, I just want to spank your ass while I'm doing it. Like that, there's ways of communicating that, like warning without, you know, because the last thing you want to do is kill the mood. But it's also just like, you know, when somebody, like if you and your partner are talking dirty to each other and one of you can't think of another line and you say something and everybody laughs, that happens. But being able to just do it, it depends on the partner. Sometimes you can get away with it. Sometimes it depends on how well you know your partner.
Yeah.
Is what I'm trying to say. Like if it's a new relationship or a hookup or anything like that, and you want to do it, that would be my advice on how to do it is phrase it that way and see what they say.
Yeah. Or say, if you stay there, I'm going to probably have to spank you. If you don't want to be spanked, this might be a good time to move, you know, or something like that, or distract me, right? You can give them and out. I think it is good to ask, especially because you might want it, like I said, more than just in a joking way. Because I know a lot of women, and I've heard a lot of women will say, "Oh yeah, once in a while they'll smack my butt and stuff, but I kind of wish they'd do it more," you know, and their partner has no idea. And so you kind of got to say that. But if you're the one,
Kate.
Yeah, if you're going to receive it, then you got to be like Aaron and be like, "Hey, I like that. Will you do that again?" You know, you gotta be direct. You gotta be direct and stuff. So, but if you're too awkward, if asking your partner to listen to this show isn't something you can do, then, and if you don't want to bring it up, particularly if somebody's gone through trauma or anything like that, then you don't want to just spank and then ask if that's okay at the middle of it, then maybe start talking just about some sexual fantasies. Maybe share your own. Maybe it's that, oh, I love the idea of you being bent over. And I, you know, I'd love to just spank your ass a little bit, you know, would that turn you on at all? Cause it would just, the thought of it's making me hot and hard and stuff. You can do any of that stuff. Share yourself. And I say, just use kindness, curiosity, and generosity. Just approach it with those three things, kindness, curiosity, and generosity. Like, just be nice, be open to hearing what they say. Even if their first reaction is hell no. Right. Then say, okay, hey, let's just talk, but tell me why it's a hell no. And you know, that just, I want to understand where you're coming from. And that always can help instead of just trying to tackle it and persuade somehow or force the issue or make somebody feel not good about disagreeing with you. So, okay. So do we need to stop here, Aaron? Are we going to have to break? And cause we've got so much more
hour in, and yeah. I knew this was going to be a, not a can of worms, but this was going to be opening, you know, Pandora's box, because you are the one who enjoys it. And that's the thing, is that the interesting thing is knowing that that was where, like, that was the one desire that you had in your marriage that didn't fulfill. And that, like, kind of started that whole ball rolling down the hill faster. And I'm not saying it wasn't rolling down the hill prior to.
Well, yeah, because I was married 12 more years.
Yeah. But I mean, you were separated before that. So you can't say that was the beginning of the end. But there was already, you know, but that whole situation going downhill so fast was another, like, yep. It'd be, and I knew that, and it's weird. It's,
I know, I prepared 8 pages of notes, right?
Yeah, was the last time I heard about you, but what happens when, you know, you have a friend whose doctor says, hey, for the next 6 weeks, I need you to get your cholesterol down. You can't eat red meat at all. Okay. What happens on week 7? They dive face first into a steak. Like, as soon as the blood test comes back and the doctor goes, oh yeah, you got this under control. Just, you know, continue to eat healthy and get some exercise and mix a salad in here and there, but you're back to normal. What do? They dive straight first into a nice big ribeye, and, you know, don't make a habit out of it. But that's the, when you explained that story to me years and years ago, when we first met, that was my thought, is like, oh, just like everybody else, that's the overcorrection of probably dove face first into that, as, you know, the first, like, oh, I'm out, I'm free, I can do whatever the fuck I want kind of thing.
No, but it wasn't, because I was still so ashamed. Even after I opened the shop, I'm telling you, it took a good couple of years. I would started to tell people, because I wrote about it in my book, which was, you know, 1.5 years into me owning the shop, almost 2 years. And I still blushed every time I told people this, right? I still can't say it with a straight face. It just, like, oh my God, I can't believe I'm admitting this. But yeah. So, okay. Well, so we'll do a whole second episode, because I have pages and pages of notes, again, because I want to help people really have some knowledge so that they, that you are comfortable, you're confident, you can go forward, and you're not feeling like, oh God, I'm going to be blindsided by something. And so to help you and your partner talk beforehand and get things straight, so that I set you up for spanking success, right? That's it. Spanking success. That's what we want. So anyway,
exactly. And if this is, like, again, like I said at the beginning, if you want your partner to listen to this, not even about the spanking part, but about more of the, hey, I want to explore more, I want to, you know, do more, like, you know what, this is a good place to end it too, because then they only have to listen to this whole first episode and know that, hey, yeah, like, I'm not into spanking. Cool. We won't go into the really gory details of spanking right now.
But it's not gory, by the way. It's not gory. We just got all sorts of hints about where. So anyway. All right. Well, thank you. Thank you. Thank you all for being here with us for Come With Us podcast, where you get the bare naked truth about love, sex, relationships, and everything pleasurable. So of course you can get even more sexy fun tips and tricks by following us on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. So don't wait. If you haven't followed us, please go online, because we want to see you online. We really do. So Aaron and I are so glad to be on the sexy journey with you. And again, sexy stuff matters, and it is our privilege to be able to share it with you, hear your stories, and let you share ours. So, and by the way, I'm Beth Darling at BethDarling.com. My book will be, my new book on 5 kinds of intimacy will be coming out at January 31st of 2023. So please go to BethDarling.com, sign up for my email list. And that way you'll get all sorts of VIP offers, and you'll learn about the book launch, and you have a chance to get an early copy even before it's released to the public. So as well as to pre-order the book. So please do that. And again, intimacy, because you got to have the emotional intimacy to give you the strength to be able to do all this sexy intimacy stuff and so on and so on. So, all right. Thanks, Aaron. Thanks. I appreciate it. And then bye, guys. We'll see you next week. And on behalf of Tina, who's not here, bye.
Thanks for listening to the Come With Us podcast. Be sure to follow us on social media at Come With Us Podcast and send in your questions, comments, and confessions to comewithusconfessions@gmail.com. Until next time, keep it fun, flirty, and naughty.